1943, just before we were taken away, kids in the neighborhood, in our village, would harass us nonstop. Dirty Jews throw tomatoes, eggs, whatever they could at us. And we couldn't even leave the house. It was that dangerous looking. And in those days, I asked my father to go outside and make them stop it, because it felt so intimidating and so dangerous that to me it was very difficult to cope with it. I often describe it like being in a house that's on fire and you cannot get out. 1,500 sets of twins that were taken to Auschwitz. The estimated number of survivors was 200 individuals. Most of them died in the experiment. I was injected with a deadly germ, and I became very ill after one of those injections, and then taken to the hospital. Mengele stood by my bed. I had very high fever. Arms, legs were swollen and painful, and I had huge red patches on my body. Mengele came in next morning and looked at my fever chart. He never examined me and said, laughing sarcastically, "Too bad she's so young. She has only 2 weeks to live." I knew he was right, but I refused to die. So for the next 2 weeks, I was between life and death. And I remember crawling on the barrack floor, fading in and out of consciousness. I was crawling to reach a faucet with water at the other end of the barrack, because this barrack was not allocated any food, nor water, nor medicine. Now, after 2 weeks, my fever broke, and then I felt a lot stronger, and it took me another 3 weeks before I was released from the hospital and reunited with Miriam. Miriam was very sick, and she looked like the living dead I left in the barrack. Dying in Auschwitz was the easiest thing in the world. Surviving was a full-time job. And many people, I would say everybody in Auschwitz was sick at one time or another. Those who gave up the struggle to live one more day, because that's all you could focus in, one more day, were as good as dead. And what would happen? You would see them sitting, looking in space without any will to live. And that was very, very dangerous. And Miriam looked like that when I got back. And I asked her, "What happened to you?" She said, "I cannot talk about it. I will not talk about it." And we did not talk about Auschwitz until 1985. Eugenics. It really started in Indiana. And the government of Indiana in 1905 passed a law that young people could not get married unless the government did a thorough study of their genetic background. By 1907, the state sterilized those people who were genetically, they called them fit to breed. They were not fit to have children, and these were not Jews, nor were they black people, nor were they handicapped people. They were young people in orphanages. So socially, they were misfitted, so to speak. And then 39 other states adopted the eugenics law, and a total of almost 164,000 Americans were sterilized under the eugenics law. Well, articles have been written about it, and Hitler read one of those articles, and he liked the idea that he had control over reproduction. Under Hitler's genetic law, or eugenics law that he passed in 1933, it stated that Jews, gypsies, physically and mentally handicapped, Jehovah Witnesses, homosexuals, and anybody who opposed him was genetically inferior and had no right to live. The Nazis were obsessed with racial purity. And in order to somehow live up to that crazy idea of racial purity, they were going to eliminate, kill all those people who might in some way threaten that purity. When I met with Dr. Munch, I asked him what did he think about the Nazi philosophy. And he said to me, it was sick. I said, what do you mean? He said, it's scientifically incorrect. Because they were going to raise tall, healthy, good-looking, pure bred Aryans. And he said, scientifically speaking, the purer a breed is, the weaker it becomes. Of course, you know that from the end, that was the first time that I kind of looked at him. A Nazi is telling me that the Nazi philosophy scientifically incorrect. I hear myself say, Dr. Munch, by any chance, do you know anything about the gas chambers in Auschwitz? And he said to me, this is a nightmare that I live with every single day of my life, and went on describing the operation of the gas chamber. Now, if we look at it, what are the chances that I meet the only Nazi ever who knew about the gas chambers in Auschwitz? To me, that is an amazing story in itself. So he said people would be told before they entered the showroom to hang their clothes and remember the hanger number so they could retrieve it when they got out of the shower. The shower room was polished, the floors were gleaming, the shower heads were gleaming. They spread a lot of perfume so people would feel comfortable. Once the shower room was packed, the doors would close. And Dr. Munch was stationed outside looking through the peephole. The gas did not come from the shower heads. They were there strictly as a camouflage. A hatch like vent opened in the ceiling. Zyklon B looks like pellets of white gravel. Canister was opened and dropped from the outside, fell to the floor. It operated like dry ice. So the gas was rising from the floor. People were trying to get away as they were suffocating on the gas, climbing on top of each other. What that meant, that the strongest people ended up on the top of the pile. He said when the people on the top of the pile stopped moving, he knew that everybody was dead. And Dr. Munch would sign one death certificate stating 1,000, 2,000, or 3,000 people were murdered. I mean, they kept everything, records of everything. I said to Dr. Munch, I am going back to Auschwitz in 1995, and I would like you to come with me and sign a document at the ruins of the gas chamber, and I want it signed in the company of witnesses so nobody could say that you didn't say it and you didn't sign this document. And he immediately said to me, I would love to. Really, what can you do if people don't believe you? I know that I had a mother and a father. I have pictures with them. I have pictures with my sisters. I also have pictures with cousins. And they all just disappeared from the face of this earth. You tell me, where are they? What happened to them, since you say it didn't happen? The United States Army, General Eisenhower said to people, take pictures. So many American GIs have lots of pictures of what happened and what they saw, because the world will not believe unless we can document it. And they still want to deny it. So now I am coming back to Terre Haute, Indiana, very, very excited that I will have a document signed, not by a survivor, not by a liberator, but actually by a Nazi who witnessed it. And I wanted to thank this Nazi doctor. I wanted to give him a meaningful gift. And I didn't know where to look. And you will find that if you have a problem, your mind will come up with a lot of answers. I did that for 10 months because none of the answers that I got seemed to be appropriate. And 10 months later, the simple idea, how about a letter of forgiveness from me to him, to Dr. Munch. I knew immediately that this was a meaningful gift. But what I discovered for myself was life-changing, because I discovered that I had the power to forgive. No one could give me that power, and no one could take it away. Now, I will tell you that in my humble opinion, forgiveness is the secret for world peace. What happens with victims, no victim ever wants to be a victim. I have never seen anybody volunteer to be a victim. So how does a person become a victim? When somebody takes away our power to use our minds or our bodies or both, by force, of course. Therefore, in my opinion, to liberate oneself from it is to forgive and take the only power one left to remove that burden. I call anger a seed for war. I don't think that there was ever a person on the face of this earth who was a very happy person who wanted to start a war. People who forgive, they are at peace with themselves, and therefore they don't want to start a war. Therefore, I call forgiveness a seed for peace. The truth is that we can teach forgiveness. The biggest gift that we could give victims who have been liberated from any oppressive situation is to teach them how to heal themselves. We cannot heal them. Each person has to do it for herself or himself. But we can plant that little seed in their mind that maybe a year, two, three, five, 10 years later, the Holocaust happened almost 70 years ago, and the majority of the survivors are still victims. Isn't that tragic?